Okay, let's start. We were discussing frequency compensation of multi-stage amplifiers, and then this is what we were doing when we last spoke. And for this architecture, we saw that if we don't do anything, if we just leave it like this, in all likelihood, this will not be a very good system with respect to frequency compensation. Because in this case, what would have happened was, without any compensation, and assuming R1, R2, and C1, C2 are of similar order, that is, the poles associated with this, which is R1 over R1 C1 and 1 over R2 C2, are of similar order. And then this is a second order circuit. So the zeta associated with this would have been pretty poor. By poor, I mean definitely much lesser than 1, which means that if we had an unit step here, right, so the output would have been, ideally, it should have been like k times the unit step. But instead of being k times, it would have gone like this and then settled. Right, so this is something that we didn't want. So then we saw there are a couple of ways of ensuring that instead of doing all this dancing around, this unit step could have been something like this, as long as we do one of these two things. We had to ensure that the poles associated with this transfer function, poles associated with the open loop transfer function, right? Poles associated with the loop gain should have been far apart. And easy way to, so by the way, when we are talking about loop gain, we are essentially saying that this is what we are interested in. In that case, this is grounded. This is V-test, V-return. So the poles associated with the open loop transfer functions are real, but they are, in this case, close by. So we had to split them apart, and we split them apart using one of these two ways. We saw that we can either put a large capacitor CC here, or we could have put a large capacitor CC here, right? So that, I mean, the poles associated with either of these two nodes, that is one over R1 C1 and 1 over R2 C2, and they move farther apart from each other. But we also saw that there is one more way of implementing the same thing, and that was using the Miller effect, right? If we put a compensation capacitor here, then effectively the pole associated with V01. So now, quickly tell me what would have been the pole associated with V01. The magnitude of that. The conductance by capacitance, conductance would have been 1 by R1 or G1, and capacitance would have been C1 plus the gain of the second stage times CC, right? So one plus, let me call it AV2 times CC. This is always approximate because you have far more other non-dominant terms associated with it. And then there was another, the pole associated with the second node also gets affected because you connect the Miller capacitance between two nodes, they are not isolated. So P2 would have been, P2 is what? Conductance will be the obvious ones is, I mean, the conductance that is connected to the node V0. There are two conductance connected directly. One is R2, another is KR. They are in parallel. So one conductance is essentially G2 plus 1 over KR. But there will be one more. This is not the dominant one, right? There is a dominant conductance. What is the dominant conductance? Would have been what? Yeah, so the second, the dominant conductance would have been because there was a feedback, there is a feedback around GM2 through the capacitor divider CCNC1. So just like we were used to finding out conductances by applying equivalent Thevenin conductances or impedances by applying a test voltage at the output at whichever node that we are trying to figure out what is the equivalent current that I am drawing. And we have done this multiple times, so I'll just write out the expression. So this essentially becomes GM2 times CC by CC plus C1. And this is again approximate because there are a whole bunch of other terms which are not dominant. And then the capacitance would have been C2, which is obvious, which is connected across Vino, and series combination of C1 and C2, right? But now it also has a zero, right? And the zero we have, since a zero is on the right-hand side, let me write these as negatives, because in case of a zero, I have to be careful with the sign. So zero is a right-hand side zero. And in this case, this is located at plus. If you don't remember, can you work it out and tell me? Where will be the zero? Okay, so the crucial thing is that, I mean, the zero will be at plus GM2 over CC. This plus is crucial because now we know that's all things about phase margin and phase lags and all, right? So now if I sketch the Bode plot of L of S, so at very low frequency, I'll have a DC gain. The DC gain will be how much? Tell me, what is the DC gain? Okay, you can put V return equal to zero. That is, if you V return equal to zero, means V not equal to zero also, right? Essentially the same thing. Okay, fine. So what is the open loop gain? Very low frequency gain. Right. So this is GM1, GM2 times R1 times R2 parallel here. Right. So this is A0 or L0. Yes, L0. And then we'll hit a first pole, P1, where this is mod of P1, because the way I have written P1, it's negative. Then let's say I put an arbitrary value of capacitance, so pole split, but let's say it split and came up here, P2. And by the way, can you comment on whether the zero appears first or P2 appears first? Now it's difficult to comment looking at this. We have to make some approximations. So let's make some approximations. That is, let's assume that the GM2 term is dominant, right? Which is a fair enough approximation. Otherwise the poles will not split. So let's assume the GM2 term is dominant. Then this becomes GM2 times CC by C plus C1. And in the denominator, we get C2 plus C1 CC by C1 plus CC. Okay, so now can you comment on whether Can you comment on whether 0 is a at lower frequency than P2 or P2 is at lower frequency than 0? And mod of, obviously, mod of P2 and mod of Z. What I'm basically asking you is that whether the 0 will appear here or 0 will appear here, approximately. You can make further simplification. Let's assume CC is much higher than C1 and C2. Because CC is something that you can put explicitly, right? You can choose to put a value of compensation capacitor which is higher than the parasitic capacitance C1. So let's assume we have done that, right? So if CC is much higher than C1, then this becomes GM2 by C2 plus C1. This is if CC much greater than C1. So now can you comment on whether the zero is at a lower frequency or a higher frequency? Zero is at a lower frequency than P2, right? Because I made the assumption that CC is much greater than C1, right? Yeah, right. So make sense? So if this assumption, so this is also not particularly true always, because it need not necessarily be that CC should be much greater than C2 also, right? The way I have sketched it, C1 and C2 are parasitic capacitances. So in that case, C1 and C2 are of similar order. So if CC is much greater than C1, then it is implied that CC is much greater than C2 also. Okay, but it need not necessarily be the case. For example, let's say you are driving an explicit load where the load is given. It's not only a parasitic load, but it's a large capacitive load. Then this need not be the case. Okay, so what I'm essentially saying is, if C2 is much greater than, or C2 is greater than CC, then zero is, or rather, let me say that if CC is greater than C2 and C1, then zero is at lower frequency than pole. But if CC is, let's say, less than C2, then zero is at higher frequency than the pole. Okay, so this location of the zero with respect to P2 depends on what is the final load capacitance, what is C2. Okay, if C2 is, let's say, a next stage that you are driving, let's say you are making an amplifier which is supposed to drive another amplifier, another input stage, which probably has its own capacitance. So if that is the case, then you have to be careful while you're doing your analysis whether zero will be at lower or the higher frequency than P2. But regardless of that, it will be there. And let's assume zero is at higher frequency for the time being, right? So let's assume zero is at a higher frequency than P2. So let's say this is zero. The analysis doesn't really change whether it's at higher or lower. You can extend it to either. So this is pole P2, and this is what is going to happen. So this is minus 20 dB per decade. This is minus 40 dB per decade. And this is again minus 20 dB per decade, right? But the crucial thing that's going to happen is, what will happen to the phase? So let's say I sketch the phase now. So what's going to happen to the phase? It will start from zero. And by that, since P1 and P2 are far apart, UGB is much higher. So effect of P1 on the phase will be minus 90 degree approximately. Then you will hit P2. You will have some effect. Then if zero and Z and P2 are nearby, not too far apart, then the effect of phase of zero will also be evident around UGB. And what will be now,
This zero is giving you phase lag or phase lead. How will you know phase lead or lag? So let's write out the transfer function once again. So your L of S is sum DC gain L of 0, 1 minus S by Z, 1 plus S by P1, 1 plus S by P2. Now note that here I am making the assumption that, okay, let's not make the assumption. Let's write it in this format. So what is the angle? How do you figure out angle? The angle becomes minus tan inverse omega by P1 minus tan inverse omega by P2. Then what is the contribution of the zero, plus or minus? I will have tan inverse omega by Z. So now in our case, I assume that P1 and P2 are negative, right? Left-hand side poles. So P1 and P2 are negative. So I should put mod of this. And zero is positive, right? So now whether I should put plus or minus in front of tan inverse omega over Z? Yeah. Minus, right? Right. So essentially you get additional phase lag due to zero. Right. So the good thing, I mean, the thing about magnitude is that you get a compensatory factor of minus or plus 20 dB per decade. It raises the magnitude, but it causes a lag in the phase. Okay. So which essentially means that what is the angle at UGB? Angle at omega U loop. This will be minus. This contribution will be minus pi by 2 because P1 is at much lower frequency than omega u loop. Then you will have minus tan inverse omega u loop by P2 minus tan inverse omega u loop by Z. So now do you think the phase margin is better or worse in the presence or absence of zero, this zero? So again, what is the phase margin? In our case, the phase margin is how much. So for phase margin, we'll have to find out the omega u loop. So essentially, we are trying to figure out what is the total phase lag at omega u loop. So this is the phase lag. This is the angle at omega u loop. And how far are we from minus pi? That's what the phase margin is, right? So let's say this is minus pi. So this is your phase margin. Okay. So now, because of this right hand side zero, are you having more phase margin or less phase margin? Less phase margin, right? So which means this is the problem. Do you agree? Do you see that? Okay, fine. So now this is a problem. I mean, one way to fix that is to say that I look at the expression of zero, and zero is GM2 over CC. One way to make the effect of zero irrelevant is to either make CC to be very low or GM2 to be very high. Right? If I push zero to a much higher frequency, then it's equivalent to saying that its contribution to that excess phase at omega mu loop is negligible. So one of the two ways that can be done is to push GM2 to a much higher value, or push CC to a much smaller value, right? So let's do the second first and see what are the impacts. So if I reduce CC, because the expression is telling me that if I reduce CC, then the zero will go to a higher frequency, then its impact on phase margin will be negligible, which is probably true. But do you see any issue with that? If I reduce CC, then zero is going to a higher frequency, right? Yeah, something with P2. What about P2? So let's say I go to the extreme case and say CC is equal to zero. Then obviously the zero doesn't exist. It's an infinite frequency. But what about P2? P2 will come near, right? P2 will essentially become, it's equivalent to the case where CC was absent. P2 would have been 1 over R2 parallel KR times C2, right? So essentially the pole splitting would have been absent. So since P2 is also a function of CC, if not directly, but indirectly, right? So it's not evident directly from here. So if you just look at this expression, there is no CC here. Right, but that expression is valid only when CC is much greater than C1, which means there is an implicit assumption that there is a CC. Okay, so that is one thing that you also have to keep in mind, that just because an expression is telling you something doesn't mean it's always valid. So what are the underlying assumptions behind that expression, you also have to keep in mind. Okay, so basically the point that I'm trying to make here is reducing CC arbitrarily will not help. But what about increasing GM2? If I increase GM2, will it help? Increasing GM2 looks like it's pushing both the zero and the pole at higher frequencies. If I can push both the zero and the pole at higher frequencies, then obviously the phase lag associated at omega mu loop will be smaller. Right, so that's good, that's better, right? So, and that is often one of the go-to ways of stabilizing multi-stage circuit, right? So you, whoever is contributing to the to that excess phase lag, right? So you try to ensure that the excess phase lag is negligible, and to do that you'll either have to make the conductance, effective conductance, higher. In this case the effective conductance is proportional to GM2, so you make GM2 higher, or you make the effective capacitance smaller. If you cannot make the effective capacitance smaller, which normally is the case, because you are often limited by capacitances, you cannot make them smaller. All you have to do is to make the effective conductance higher. So you make GM2 higher, right? So now how do you make GM2 higher? So how will you make GM2 higher? Note that I'm talking about making GM2 higher, not the gain of the second stage higher. They are different things. I want to make GM2 higher, then what should I do? Without compromising the gain. Pardon? Increase W of the second transistor, right? M2. Right? Okay, so if I increase W of second transistor, what is going to happen? What about the DC biasing conditions? I increase the W of second transistor. Will the current in the second transistor remain constant, or it will change? It will change, right? So I will increase W or decrease W to increase GM2? I will increase W. So the current will increase or decrease? It will increase. Great. So GM2 is increasing. But what about the quiescent biasing conditions? Do you think they are going to get affected? Right, so your drop across R2 will be higher, so your transistor M2 will move towards linear. So in order to restore that, what do you need to do? You have to increase or decrease R2. You have to decrease R2, right, so that you don't have too much drop across R2, right? So but by doing that, you can effectively keep the gain constant also, because you are increasing GM2, reducing R2. So in principle, you can keep the gain constant. That's good. But you are also able to increase GM2, because increasing GM2 is effectively making our negative feedback circuit more stable. Okay, so another consequence of doing all these things is that you essentially end up burning more power, right? So increasing GM2 means you have to increase W or increase current. However you do, you end up burning more power. So that is one of the side effects of, or the penalties of stabilizing your negative feedback circuits. Okay, so you end up burning more power in some stage. Okay, simply because you are trying to split the poles, which means since poles are conductance over capacitances, if the capacitances are of the same order, if you split the poles, which means you have to make either one conductance very small or other conductance very high. If you want to make the one conductance very high, you have to burn more power. Right? Conductance is effectively a function of current. Okay. Or in this case, the transconductance is a function of current. Any questions? Okay. So the other thing that we should keep in mind in this case, clearly, the way I have sketched it, P2 is before UGB. So if P2 is before UGB, can you comment on the phase margin? Is it more than 45 degree, less than 45 degree? Let's say P2 is exactly at omega U loop. Let's make that assumption. Maybe P2 is exactly at omega U loop. Then can you comment on the phase margin? No, right? Phase margin of minus 90 means what? What type of system is that? Phase margin of phase margin of 90, which means you have a phase lag of 90, right? You have a phase lag of 90, which means that this is 90, right? So phase lag of 90 means what type of system? First order system, right? So you definitely, so when I say you, now let's say your this guy, what I'm trying to get at here is that, let's say your second pole is exactly at UGB. What is the phase margin in this case? What is the phase lag at UGB? Phase lag due to P1 is how much? And phase lag due to P2? Minus 45, right? So essentially, you have 135 degree phase lag. How much margin you have? 45 degree. So if P2 is exactly at omega U loop, your phase margin is 45 degree. And 45 degree phase margin is not particularly good for good step response, right? We saw, right? Approximately 76 degree we want if we want a clean settling, which doesn't ring. So which means that additional poles, extra poles other than the first order system. So whatever extra poles we require, they have to be at higher frequency than omega U. Right. So that's what we concluded the previous class. We said that the system should look like a first order system around omega U loop, or your system should have a loop gain should have a roll off of minus V per decade around omega U loop to have a decent phase margin without any ringing and all. Right. So now if that is the case, so in this case, let's see, in this case, can you comment on whether the phase margin is better than 45 degree or less than 45 degree, the way I have sketched it? It will be less than 45 degree, right? Because clearly P1 again gives you 90 degree and P2 is giving you more than 45. Because this tan inverse of that ratio is more than one. Omega U loop over P2 is more than one. So you are getting more than 45 degree, which means you have a phase margin of poorer than 45 degree, which means not particularly a good settling, not particularly a good closed loop response for escape input. So if that's the case, then I want to fix it. Now, one way to fix it was the thing that we just discussed, increase GM2. If we increase GM2, both P2 and Z goes to a higher frequency, and that's definitely something that we can do. So this was like this, right? So if I increase GM2, both this P2 will probably move here, Z will probably move here, and this guy will. Maybe P2 will move here, Z will move there, and let's say this is P2 and this is Z. So this looks like a minus 20 dB per decade roll off around omega U loop and should be fine. Okay, but the issue is you have to burn more power. You're burning more power to buy stability. That's fine. That's one way of going about it. But let's say I don't want to burn more power. What is the other way of fixing is? This is one way of fixing, undoubtedly. But I don't want to burn more power, but I still want to make the system stable. Okay. So what I'm essentially saying is that I don't, wherever P2 is, let the P2 be there. Wherever Z is, let the Z be there. But I want the system to be stable. So what can I do?
You can write and sketch it a bit more cleanly. Let's say this is.
Okay, so I don't want to tamper with P2 and Z, but I want to move, I want to make the system stable. Decrease omega u loop, right? So in other words, what I am saying is, if I have to make the system stable, I have to ensure that this 20 dB per decade roll off decides the omega u loop. Right, that's what I'm saying, right? So so essentially what I'm saying is that this will probably be a stable response, right? So which means that I have to decrease omega u loop, that's good, but then I have to know what is the transfer function of this guy, right? If I know what is the transfer function of that guy, what is the equation of that 20 dB per decade roll off is in terms of the component parameters, then I can easily play around with the design and see what needs to be done in order to push it left or right. Okay, so the next thing to understand is what will be the transfer function of, or what will be the equation of that line segment. Okay, what I'm essentially asking is that what is the equation of this line segment. So for that we already have the weapon to do that. So this is essentially L of S will be A naught by S by T1, right? I can neglect zero and the second pole to find out the expression of that line segment. So this becomes A naught T1 over S. Or A naught is GM1 R1 times the second stage gain, which is GM2 times effective let me call that R2 to be the effective second stage output conductance, right? So R2O, let's say, times P1. P1 was what? 1 over R1 times C1 plus the second stage gain, that is GM2 R. So let me just say AV2 here. So this becomes AV2 times CC, right? Make sense, or am I going too fast? I just replaced the equation of P1, whatever was P1. This is P1, right? So I just replace the equation of P1 here. So that becomes 1 over R1 times effective capacitance. Effective capacitance is C1 plus the Miller capacitance multiplied by the gain of the second stage. And the first part is, this is the DC gain. Okay. So and divided by S, everything divided by S. Okay. So if we make the approximation that this guy is more than C1, which is a fair enough approximation because CC is getting multiplied to the gain of one stage, right? So then you see something very simplified expression that comes into being. So firstly, this R1 cancels off by S. Then this becomes AV2 times CC. So this guy goes. This is not there, so this becomes GM1 by ASCC. Okay, so which essentially means that equation of this part of the line is GM1 by ASCC. Okay, so this makes life considerably simpler because now if I want to ensure that omega u loop falls within that line segment, all we have to ensure is that find that value of GM1 for which this becomes equal to for which GM1 by omega U loop 9 CC becomes 1. Right? And let's say you made some calculations, you put your circuit together, and you find that this is what it is, right? It is in the way I have sketched it, this is what it is. Your omega U loop doesn't fall inside that line segment. Then what design choice will you make? What decision you will make, or what change will you make to ensure that omega U loop falls within that line segment? See, ultimately, what do I need to do? What I am planning to do, I am planning to move this guy. I am not changing P2 or Z. So I have to move this guy somewhere here. So this is what I am shooting for now. Right? So this will be the new omega U loop. So for this red plot, I will have a decent phase margin. Right? So since I'll have a decent phase margin for this red plot, so I need to push that black plot to the red plot. So what do I need to do? I have to do something with P1, but I mean, now I have this expression here now, right? So can you tell me what do I need to do to push this yellow part to a lower frequency? Decrease GM1, right? I can either decrease GM1 or I can increase CC, right? So let's say I decrease GM1. That seems like GM1 doesn't affect any other parameter, right? GM1 neither affects P2 or Z. I don't want to tamper them. I can simply decrease GM1. If I decrease GM1, the omega U loop shifts to a lower frequency, right? So great. So if omega U loop shifts to a lower frequency, I'm good. So if I decrease GM1, can you also comment on the location of P1? P1 will also proportionally decrease, right? P1 will also proportionally decrease. And what happens to the DC gain? Okay, so I jumped my gun, jumped the gun to some extent initially. So I shouldn't have commented on P1 right away. So if I only decrease GM1, will it affect P1? No, right? P1 is not dependent on GM1. It will not affect P1. But if I only decrease GM1, what happens to the DC gain? Increases or decreases or remains the same? It decreases, right? DC gain is GM1, first stage gain times second stage gain. First stage gain is GM1 times R1. If I only decrease GM1, the first stage gain reduces. So overall DC gain also reduces. Okay. So that's not good. So if I have to restore the DC gain, because we are ultimately doing these multi-stage things to get high DC gain. Right? So if I have to restore that first stage gain, what do I need to do? Increase R1. Right? That I can do because ultimately I have reduced GM1, which means I have reduced current, which means I can increase R1. Right? So if I increase R1, now if I increase R1, can you comment on the location of P1? It will move to a lower frequency, right? That makes sense, right? So now, I mean, the consequence of decreasing GM1 is not particularly that P1 moves to a lower frequency, but if you tie it up with the constraint that I'm keeping the DC gain same, then P1 moves to a lower frequency, right? So essentially, this is what's going to happen. So your P1 will move to a lower frequency and your system will stabilize. Okay. Yes. Yeah, P1 has a Miller effect, but with GM. With GM. GM2, right? Not GM1. Right? So Miller effect is across the transconductance. Miller effect gives you the multiplication of the gain across which it has been connected, right? Okay, fine. Any other questions? Yes. Okay, so only increasing R1. His question is a good question. His question is increasing R1 might push the first stage MOSFET into linear region. But can any of you help comment on whether this is a doable solution in our case? GM1 has reduced, right? We are reducing GM1 to move the omega UGB, right? The omega U loop to a lower frequency, we are reducing GM1. Because we are reducing GM1, we have that additional headroom to increase R. Otherwise, we wouldn't have, right? So as you see that, you see multiple constraints that come into picture when you design something like this. There is no one size fits all, right? So depending upon what type of constraints for which you are designing your amplifier, you'll have to make an appropriate decision. So design is always about decision making. And decision making is more about understanding what the limitations are, what are the approximations are. It's more about that than about calculations. The calculations always are important, analysis is important. You have to ultimately validate everything using analysis and calculation, but decision makings are not done using calculations, right? It's equivalent to think, you can think of that when you cross a road and you see a car coming at certain speed, you don't sit and calculate at what speed the car is coming, whether should I be crossing the road now, it's safe to do or not, right? So you know intuitively whether you will be able to cross it. Then, I mean, if you get hit, then different thing. Then you go ahead and analyze that whether your intuition is correct or not. Like the same thing here, right? So you assume something based on your intuition. You put your circuit together. If it rings like crazy, you go ahead and see whether your initial approximations were right or not. Then you start. Your design never works first time. Just like coding, when you code, you will always have bug. You probably have missed a semicolon here, semicolon there. Maybe the internal loop is not working properly or something like that, then you go and fix it, right? So same thing here. When you do anything for the first time, it will never work. But how you debug it or not will depend on what is your level of understanding of the constraints. Okay, so before I move on from this, any questions? Because I see class to be very muted, so that scares me. Any questions about negative feedback? So we'll take a break from negative feedback for some time after this. So we'll move to something else. So before we close on this chapter for a couple of lectures, any questions? No? Okay, fine. Okay, so so as you see that, I mean, gain is not the only thing, right, for which we are designing amplifier. Open loop transfer function is not the only thing that matters. Ultimately, what matters is putting things in a closed loop, making it stabilize, and to ensure that your DC gain is high, but also when you put it in a negative feedback loop, your closed loop transfer function is also quite well behaved. Now, to do this, as you can see that everything is a strong function of GM. Right, so your location of the pole is a strong function of GM. Location of the omega U loop is a strong function of GM. And obviously the gain is also a function of GM. So which essentially means that if you have to make an amplifier which is stable across temperature variations, across humidity, across any variation, right? So you'll have to ensure that the GM doesn't change too much, right? I mean, just like if an amplifier is supposed to work in the month of December, it should be equally effective in the month of May, right? So even though the temperature probably has changed by 40 degrees, I mean, I'm talking about Kanpur, but depending upon wherever you are in the world, it should be able to tolerate wide swings in temperature also. But what is GM? GM is if I have a transistor, and I bias it with a voltage source, VGSQ, and I have some
I have held some VDSQ here. So I'll get some current IDSQ. And the GM, appropriate GM is mu n C aux W over L VDSQ minus threshold voltage.
Okay. So now clearly in this case, from your experiences in doing solid state devices or allied courses, you know that mu n and threshold voltages are strong functions of temperature, right? So so which essentially means that if temperature changes, GM changes, and it looks like it's very it will change drastically, right? So it if you do a simulation of this, you will see that easily GM changes by plus minus 20%, if not more, depending upon what type of technology you are using. So which means that everything, all the parameters that you have so painstakingly taken time to understand, calculate, and design, all of them are going to change with temperature, right? So something that works in the month of December might not work in the month of May. That's all it means, right? So which means that this is not something that we would like to do. We have to ensure that the GM is, at least if not directly proportional, or if not too much dependent, but at least less dependent on temperature than whatever this expression is suggesting us. Okay, so now one might turn around and say that, hey, I have this expression also. I can write the GM expression as 2 mu n C aux W over L times IDSQ. Right? This is an equally valid expression. Right? Algebraically, there is no difference between the expression on the top and the expression in the bottom. So in the top expression, it seems like if threshold voltage changes by, let's say, 10, if threshold voltage changes by, what is this telling us? If VTA changes by, from, let's say VTA changes from VTH naught to VTH naught plus delta VTH. So how much will GM change? How much will GM change? Right, so GM will increase or decrease? Delta VTH is positive value, so GM will decrease, right? So delta GM will be minus mu n C aux W over L times delta VTH. Or in other words, I can write it in this format, delta VTH by V overdrive times V overdrive, which means this is what? Minus GM naught times delta VTH by V overdrive. Right? So what this is telling us is that, I mean, not, this is not telling us anything that we didn't know earlier. What it is telling us is that delta GM is directly proportional to the change of threshold voltage. Right? It comes directly out of algebra. But what is this expression telling us? This seems like this is independent of threshold voltage. If I change delta VTH, if I change threshold voltage by delta VTH, and if I stare at that expression, it seems like GM hasn't changed at all. Right? So is that a right statement to make? Why not? Right? So ID is a function of threshold voltage, which means there is an embedded threshold voltage term associated with it. I'm just hiding it under ID. Okay? So that's correct. But let's say now I tell you that I have a constant current source. Right? I have a constant current source ID, IDSQ. Let's say, okay. So let's say I tell you that somehow I have been able to fix the current here. I don't know how, but I have fixed the current, right? Some magic I have done, I have fixed the current IDSQ here. So now can you comment on whether GM will be dependent on threshold voltage? Yes or no? I can't hear. Yes, so why? Note that I haven't told you, but let's say IDSQ is fixed. IDSQ is not dependent on threshold voltage. IDSQ fixed means IDSQ is not dependent on threshold voltage. So if IDSQ is not dependent on threshold voltage, will GM depend on threshold voltage? From first expression, it seems like, but from the second expression, it doesn't seem like, right? So what is happening? Right. So if IDSQ is fixed, if I say IDSQ is fixed and threshold voltage has changed, what must have happened? VGS should also have changed, right? Otherwise, this is not possible. Right? If current is fixed, and threshold voltage has changed, and still current hasn't changed, which means what? VGS has increased. If threshold voltage has increased, current hasn't changed, which means VGS has increased by the same amount. It is only then it's possible to keep the current same. Right? Does that make sense? Okay, fine. So now, which essentially, the reason I'm harping on this is to tell you that, let's say I have a constant current source, right? Let's say, how do I make a current fixed? So just like you have a battery, it keeps the voltage fixed, right? So if I get a constant current source, I can probably make a current fixed. Okay. So now, and if I say that, just like a battery, you can plug it in across two terminals and say that the current voltage is fixed, I will push current into the drain of the drain of the transistor and say that current is fixed. I can do that. Okay. So what I'm saying is I have a constant current source, I naught, and I push it into the drain of the transistor. Whatever happens, this current is fixed. Right? Ideal current source, this current is fixed. So if I do this, if I leave it like this, will this work? The question is, let's say I go to the lab and I take the transistor and I take a constant current source and plug it in like this, just the way I have shown it here. Will this work? Why not? We need to apply a VGS properly, right? So let's say I do this, and what are the likely scenarios? What might happen if I connect it like this? It's open, but something is going to happen, right? What are you going to observe? Somebody said here. Current source will basically zap off, right? Or something will happen to the current source, is it? Okay, I agree something will happen to the current source, because ultimately you don't have an ideal current source. But let's say you have an ideal current source, then what is going to happen? No, I'm saying I went to the lab. It's quite a likely scenario, right? You breadboard a circuit, you forgot to connect the input. That's quite common, in fact, right? If you go to SA201 lab, right, that is what the first thing we check, right? Whether everything is connected or not. So you connected it like this, maybe there was an open circuit or something. This is what it is. And now what are you going to observe? Drain voltage will either increase or decrease. I don't know whether it will spike or not, but something will happen. So if I observe the drain voltage, this drain voltage will either go up, right? Because maybe the transistor is off. If the transistor is off, maybe the current source is pushing in current into a open circuited terminal. So that voltage will keep on going up and maybe shut off the current source. A likely scenario, right? Or it might as well be that maybe the transistor is on, I don't know something, whatever it was connected here, maybe it was got zapped or something. So maybe this voltage will go down. Either of these two possibilities can be there. But the moot point is that you will not be able to understand, you'll not be able to ascertain what is the bias condition of this transistor if you simply connect it like this, right? You basically leave it to fate, right? It probably will be biased, probably might not be biased. And in all likelihood, it will not be biased, right? So now the question is, given that if I can bias a transistor with a constant current source, right? If I can bias a transistor with a constant current bias, looks like the GM is insensitive to threshold voltage variation, then which means I would like some way of fixing the GM using constant current source. So what should I do? So now clearly, the problem in this case is, in a transistor, if cause is the current in the transistor is due to a voltage that is applied between the gate and the source, right? So the cause is the VGS, effect is IDS. But it's easy to visualize that I apply a battery across VGS and some current comes out, because that's the cause and effect scenario. But here our requirement is I want to fix the current, which means I'm trying to fix the effect, right? I'm trying to fix the output. But if I can I just fix the output and hope that the corresponding VGS appears at the input? I cannot. Right? We have to do something. We have to put some circuitry or something we have to do to ensure that when I apply the current at the output terminal, the appropriate VGS appears at the input terminal. It will not appear as if automatically. It is our job to make sure that it appears. Okay. So now, if we have to do that, then what is the... So let's say again, let's go to the lab, right? So, and we do the thought experiment once again. So I connected it like this, and I am observing, let's say, I mean, I am observing, and I know that I have to connect a battery here, right? Because this is the cause. VGS is the cause, and this current IDSQ is the effect. Okay. And let's assume that there is a small capacitance associated with it, because it helps in visualizing what happens to the current, because infinite impedance is difficult to visualize. Okay, so now let's say I go to the lab and I ask you that, say, this is the battery, this is VBAT, this is a variable battery, and this is a fixed current source I naught. Find an algorithm to bias this transistor with a constant current source I naught, just like I have done here. So what is the steps that you are going to follow when you go to the lab? You don't know what is mu and C aux, all those things. I mean, you haven't yet characterized the transistor, because to characterize, you have to bias. Is the question clear? Question is, we will, the question is why. So what I'm saying is, what is the, let's say you go to the lab and I ask you to bias the constant, this transistor with a constant current source. So what is the algorithm? What will you do? What are the steps? What are you going to see? What are you going to observe? What are the actions that you're going to take? So forget about this thing. Let's say this is a part of your TA duty, SC201 lab. You go and you have to bias your transistor using constant current source and a variable battery connected at VGS. So what are you going to do? Pardon, I couldn't hear you. You will observe the voltmeter, you are observing the voltage across the capacitance. Okay, then what decision are you going to make based on that? Okay, you are observing the voltage here. So let's say you are observing the voltage here. Let's call this VD. Right, the drain voltage you are observing. Fine. So you will get some voltage, right? You connect a voltmeter, it will give you a voltage. That's its job. But with the with that information, what will you do? Let's say it gives you 1 volt. Fine. So what? So you are going to vary the VBAT, right? What are you going to do? Tell me. So let's say again, I went to the lab, I connected it, right? So tell me some numbers. So VBAT I connected to, give me a value. 10 volts. Okay. So let's say I connected VBAT to be, this is 10 volt. And let's say I naught, I want you to be 1 milliamps. Right. And you observe VD. Give me a number, VD. What did you observe? PD2V. Any number now, everything is correct. Tell me a number. 2 volt. Okay. Fine. So what is this telling you? Is it telling you something? This is the observation, right? This is one data point that you got. So what is this telling you?
If you measure PD after some time, it keeps remains constant and you can assume you bias over it.
Okay, you can. So ultimately, what if the transistor is ideal? That is, if the transistor doesn't have an output impedance, then yeah. So what's going to happen is, if the current between the I naught and the current between the transistors are not balanced, then the excess current will flow into the capacitance and it will either go up or go down, right? Which I agree. But in general, if you go to the lab, you don't have an ideal transistor. You will have a real transistor where you have channel length modulation and all those things, right? Which means that it will settle to some value. Okay. You don't need the RDS value. You are not asking you to find out the exact output, right? So let's say I tell you that the threshold voltage is 1 volt. Let's say you know ballpark range, threshold voltage is 1 volt. Can you comment on whether the transistor in this case is in what state? It's in linear region, right? When it's in linear region, what information is it telling you? In terms of the strength of the I naught and the strength of the transistor M1, is the transistor looking for more current than 1 milliamp, or is the transistor looking for less current than 1 milliamp? In other words, what I'm saying is, if for a VGS of 10 volt, is the transistor hoping for more than 1 milliamp current to come out of linear region? Ultimately, I want the transistor to be in saturation, right? That's an implicit assumption. So this is a linear region. I have to make sure the transistor is in saturation. So what should I do? I have to decrease VBAT, right? So in other words, in terms of the difference of this current of I naught and IDSQ, right? So let's say this is ID sat. Let's say we want IDSQ to be ID saturation current, because ultimately that is our goal. We want the output current, we want the transistor to be in saturation. So what is this telling us? This information is telling us, is IDSQ is less than ID sat or more than ID sat? IDSQ is less than IV, sir. Correct? Okay. So if IDSQ is less than ID sat, which means that transistor is looking for more current. Correct? So in other words, the transistor is stronger than the amount of current that you are feeding it. Correct? So in other words, you are looking for a case in which either you have to increase the current source or you have to make the transistor weaker. It is only if either of these two conditions is satisfied, you have a chance of pushing the transistor into a saturation region. Does that make sense? Okay. So since I have told you that the current is constant, that you cannot do, which means you have to weaken the transistor, right? You have to make the transistor less hungry for current, right? So you have to weaken the transistor. So how do you weaken the transistor in terms of its drive strength? You reduce the VGS, right? So in other words, what is the algorithm then? The algorithm is, you observe the output drain voltage. If you find that the output drain voltage is, if you find the output drain voltage is lower than whatever it is, whatever you want it to be, right? Then the conclusion is the transistor is stronger than whatever it needs to be. So you have to make it weaker. So you have to reduce VBAT, right? Now, going by the point that he was trying to make, let's come back to theory. And if I make the assumption that it's an ideal transistor without channel length modulation, then what's going to happen? So let's assume that there is a time dependence associated with this. I connected the I connected this setup together and turned the circuit on. And let's say this is 10 volt. What's going to happen to this voltage? This voltage will start off from somewhere and then decrease. Right? The transistor will eventually go into linear, but it will start off from somewhere and then decrease. So decreasing voltage here means decreasing voltage here means the transistor is stronger than necessary. I have to weaken it. Right? So the action that I need to take is if the drain voltage decreases, I need to reduce the gate voltage. Right? So if drain voltage reducing means the transistor is stronger than the current source, I have to weaken the transistor, which means I have to reduce the gate voltage. Does that make sense? Okay. So if that, and if it's the other way around, let's say I plugged in the circuit and this voltage is increasing. I observe that voltage is increasing. What is the conclusion? The conclusion is I naught is stronger than the transistor, right? The transistor is expecting some current, but I naught is pushing in more current than whatever it is expecting. So the output voltage is increasing. Since the output voltage is increasing, what is the appropriate action that I need to take? I have to increase VGS, right? So if you have a variable voltage source and you are in the lab, you are going to observe the drain voltage and you are going to tweak the voltage source in an appropriate direction by looking at the drain voltage, right? So in electronically, what we can simply do is to say what the argument is, if drain voltage increases, I need to increase the gate voltage. If drain voltage decreases, I need to reduce the gate voltage, which means that a simpler solution is doing this. Right? So if I do this, then naturally, whatever I talked about till now in plain English will get done. Right? So if this is the case, and I'm sure all of you know this is a diode connected transistor. This is always in saturation, right? So what is the GM of this? GM of this transistor is, now can you comment on if threshold voltage of this transistor, of this configuration, let's say threshold voltage was 1 volt and it increased from 1 volt to 1.11 volt. So will the GM change? It's not going to change, right? Because the current is constant. So what's going to change? Threshold voltage has increased. Something has to change in the circuit. But VGS will change, right? The VGS will auto adjust. So if this guy increases, if the threshold voltage increases, right? If the threshold voltage increases by delta VTH, VGS will increase by delta VTH, right? Thereby keeping the current constant and thereby also keeping the GM constant. Okay, so this is one way of generating a transconductance which is invariant to changes in threshold voltage, right? At least if we go by the square law model of our transistor, right? In practice, the square law model is not really valid. So if you put this circuit in your circuit simulator and simulate, you will see that there is some variation because your mu n Cox W over L VGS minus VT whole squared, that model is not strictly valid. That is a simplified model. But nevertheless, the variation will be lower than if you just bias your transistor using a constant voltage source between VGS. Okay, so this type of biasings are often used. So we will see from the next class how we can use this type of biasings to make our circuits more robust.